Your Majesty, ladies and gentlemen, as Vice Chancellor of Stockholm University, it is an honor and a great pleasure for me to welcome you all today to Aula Magna. We are, of course, particularly honored by the presence of Your Majesty today on the occasion of this open lecture. A big role for a small country, carbon dioxide emissions, climate justice, and how Sweden can lead the way, by Professor Raymond Pierrehumbert from Chicago University, holder of the King's Guest Professorship in Environmental Sciences this year. We are very happy and grateful to have been given this great opportunity at Stockholm University, but it must be added that this is also thanks to our application for such an outstanding scholar within climate research as Raymond Pierrehumbert. Research on climate, seas, and environment is one of our profile areas at Stockholm University. Our research environment for climate research is indeed, I dare to say, leading in Sweden with exceptional breadth and excellent research. The pleasure to welcome Raymond Pierrehumbert to Stockholm for this guest professorship is all the greater as he has already a long history with Stockholm University and Sweden. Usually, he comes here every year to visit the Department of Meteorology, though usually at a nicer time of the year. And he's part of the External Advisory Council for the Bolin Centre for Climate Research, where his contributions for developing the centre are most appreciated. When in Stockholm, I've been told from enthusiastic scholars at the department, Ray walks around and discusses in a very informal and engaged way with everybody, professors and students alike. Thanks to his breadth of interests and his depth of knowledge within a broad spectrum of planetary sciences, I understand many have come to enjoy these dialogues, even when his comments are quite critical. Others are much better suited than I to comment upon his research. But let me underline that I was pleased to discover that, though a natural scientist, his broad interests also cover the relations between climate and society, the relation between the climate question and economy in general, as well as social costs. I'm particularly pleased that today's panel, together with the Minister for the Environment, will have such a broad scientific profile, as I'm convinced that in order to answer the fundamental questions in climate research today, we need to address them from many different disciplines. Allow me also to tell a final anecdote. During my first year as Vice Chancellor, we made a first attempt to apply for Professor Pierrehumbert, but unfortunately, at that time, we were unsuccessful. Then the opportunity to apply for the Tage Erlander professorship turned up. But no, Ray showed no interest at all. It had to be the King's professorship. With my congratulations to his success the second time, and once again, my gratitude to His Majesty for enabling this guest professorship, I now want to welcome today's moderator, Professor Mikael Tjernström, on stage, Chair of the Department of Meteorology.
Thank you, Astrid. I'd also like to welcome you, everyone, to this event. I will try and guide us through this morning's program, and if I do a good job, you should not notice my presence too much. Two major items on the program is, of course, the lecture by Ray, and there will also be a panel debate with four participants after that. After Ray's lecture, there will be opportunity for the audience to ask questions. I hope the school classes have prepared questions, and if you haven't, think about questions to ask during the lecture. Ray will also participate in the panel debate, so if you run out of time or you think of things afterwards to ask, you can also ask during the panel debate. Before, however, the royal lecture, I would like to invite two other climate scientists at my department to give some opening remarks and to introduce Ray. And those will be Professors Johan Nilsson and Rodrigo Caballero. So please, Johan.
I have the honor to set the stage by presenting, give you a flavor of what climate science is today. A non-specific way to phrase it is to say that climate is what you expect and weather is what you get. Having said that, climate science today deals with what sets the physical properties on planets that orbits around stars. It could be the Earth, it could be other planets in our solar systems, and it could also be a large number of planets that have been discovered outside our own solar systems. And we are, of course, interested whether there are conditions for life in the universe. And in that context, climate science is important. I will give you some aspects of climate science by introducing three scientists that were based here in Stockholm during at least large parts of their career. The first one was Svante Arrhenius. He won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1903, but he had diverse interests. Little over 100 years ago, Svante Arrhenius was curious about ice ages, which by then had become a more almost an established fact from geological research. And there were different theories of why the temperature could drop on Earth. And Svante Arrhenius had his own theory. He knew that carbon dioxide absorbs thermal radiation from the Earth and warms the Earth. So he set out to do a calculation of how much change in carbon dioxide you have to make before you can get an ice age. And that was a remarkable feat that took him over 1 year to complete with pen and paper. But he came actually to a fantastically accurate prediction, which still is very impressive today. Then the next person to introduce is called Gustaf Rossby, who founded the Department of Metrology in 1947. Rossby is one of the real giants in metrology, and he's important in that context that he had a very broad approach to the subject of metrology. He was the one who was really pushing numerical weather forecasts, but he also realized that there were other applications of metrology. And environmental pollution and air pollution was an issue that surfaced in the 50s. And he inspired his colleagues to work on this, and he realized that carbon dioxide plays important role here, and it's a complicated issue because it involves geology, biology, metrology, and oceanography. Rossby himself did not do all that much in the field himself, but he, his former student, Bert Bolin, he told him that he should change his subject from what he had done in his thesis that was focused on weather forecasting, and focus all his efforts on trying to understand atmospheric chemistry and environmental pollutions. Bert worked a lot on the role of carbon dioxide and made very important contributions on how carbon dioxide is cycled between the ocean, what we call the biosphere, and the atmosphere. Bert also played a very important role in spreading out the possibility that human emissions of carbon dioxide can change climate. and he was one of the founders of United Nations International Panel on Climate Change. And by that I come to, you may wonder why I have a picture of Svalbard. And the reason is twofold. I tell you two small stories. The first one is that in the mid-50s, Rossby told Bert Bolin to go on a field campaign into the high Arctic to do carbon dioxide measurements with the specific aim to see whether the content of carbon dioxide was changing in the atmosphere. That enterprise actually failed, but that's one reason to show a picture of Svalbard. Another is that you see a wooden construction. That's an old cable car for transporting coal that was mined in Longyearbyen. It's not in use anymore. Today, Svalbard is in the high Arctic. It's a cold place. But 50 million years ago, it was warm, although it was almost at the same latitude. It was within the Arctic Circle, but it was warm. There was less vegetation, and that vegetation deposited the coal that today still is mined there. And that illustrates that we are now entering a stage where not only geology, oceanography, metrology, and biology affects climate, but also human activities. And by that, I leave it to my colleague, Rodrigo Caballero, to guide you into Ray's presentation with some recollections.
So my aim now is just to give you a brief introduction to Ray as a scientist. And I'd like to do that by citing this well-known sentence attributed to the ancient Greek poet Archilochus. The fox knows many things, but the hedgehog knows one big thing. So it's a kind of cryptic and suggestive phrase that has been interpreted in many different ways over the centuries. Here I'd like to use it to say that there are, broadly speaking, two types of scientists. One scientist digs deep into a certain field, grapples with the incredible complexity and detail that underlies every field of science, and is, if you like, a primary producer of science. Another kind of scientist acts to extract the basic insights and fundamental mechanisms that underpin a given field, and does so even in many different fields, and creates, you know, synthesis, creates connections between different fields and different subfields. So there is no value judgment in this division. I mean, each the foxes and the hedgehogs live in some sort of ecological balance, and you know, the scientific enterprise would essentially stop if either of these two types of scientists were not there. So the important thing is not really what kind of scientist you are, but how good you are at being one particular kind of scientist. And in that context and with that framework, I would say that Ray is one of the foremost foxes in our field of climate sciences. And to give you a feel for his, you know, foxiness, here's a short a non-exhaustive list of the fields that Ray has worked in. And in each of these fields, he has really acted to extract, you know, distill, if you like, the essence of each of these fields, clarify the fields, and he has left each of these subfields, you know, stronger and clearer than he found them. Okay. In the early part of his career, which included some faculty appointments, I guess, first at MIT and then at Princeton University, he dealt mostly with atmospheric dynamics, that is, with the fluid dynamics of the atmosphere, how the winds move, why they move the way they do, and why they form the patterns that we observe. And how these motions transport and mix constituents in the atmosphere, such as, for instance, atmospheric moisture, which plays a very important role in climate. In the early 90s, he moved to a professorship at the University of Chicago that he still holds. And there, his interest turned to more properly climate science. So this involves then the interaction between the energy inputs, as Johan was pointing out, the energy inputs and the energy outputs from the climate system and how they interact with the motion within the climate system. So he did some important work in understanding this, how climate system functions in the present day, and then moved into, given this insight, he moved into understanding how the climate may have worked in different time periods, particularly in deep time, so very far in the past, and there was, with particular emphasis on this exciting period called the Snowball Earth, in which the Earth was, we believe, entirely covered with ice all the way to the equator. Then he moved even further afield to planetary climates, the climates of Mars, Titan, and more recently exoplanets. These are planets outside our own solar system, which we are just beginning to discover today. So this is a very cutting-edge topic. And more recently, he's then come back down to Earth and has used the insights gained into the science of climate to inform environmental policy and economic policy, and also geoengineering, which is becoming a very important topic. In fact, a report on geoengineering had just been released by the National Research Council in the US, in which Ray was a contributor. So without further ado, I think this gives you a palette, a feel for the kind of things that Ray has done in his career. I think we have all learned from him. I certainly have. I'm a long-time collaborator of Ray's, and he's probably the single person I've learned most in this field from. And I think, from what I understand of his content of his lecture today, you'll get a feel for this span, this incredible breadth of research that he has undertaken. So, Ray.
Tack så mycket, Rodrigo. Faktiskt, jag tycker jättemycket om igelkottar. Jag tänkte börja bara lite grann på svenska, sen ska jag byta till engelska. Ers majestät, statsrådet, rektor, mina damer och herrar och särskilt alla ungdomar, jag önskar er alla hjärtligt välkomna. När jag först kom till Sverige för 30 år sedan, följer jag verkligen för Sverige och dess språk och litteratur. Varje land har sina egenskaper, men jag tror att om alla kunde vara lite mer som i Sverige skulle världen vara en bättre plats. Jag är oerhört tacksam mot konungen och konung Karl XVI Gustavs 50-års fond för att ha gjort min vistelse i år i Stockholm möjlig. Den första halvan av året har varit fyllt av spännande forskningsmöjligheter och jag ser fram emot den andra halvan. Idag ska jag prata om hur energibeslut vi fattar idag kommer att avgöra klimatet som våra efterkommande kommer att leva med i tusentals år. Och hur Sverige kan leda resten av världen mot en framtid fri från fossila bränslen och ett klimat som våra efterkommande kommer att trivas i. Och nu ska jag byta till engelska så att du behöver inte höra på min Chicago-brytning hela tiden här. Så. Ja, om det finns en Chicago-brytning, faktiskt var jag född i New Jersey. Big role for a small country. This is one of my many favorite novels in Swedish. Many people don't realize, I'm sure you've all read it, many people don't realize that Nils Holgersson's Underbara Resa was written by Selma Lagerlöf, actually as a geology textbook, a kind of a geology or geography text. It was meant as a way to engage school children in the diverse economic and physical geography of Sweden. And I think it's very successful at that. And it became, of course, much more. It's a really, truly wonderful, wonderful story. I'm going to take you on a similar underbara resa, but through the carbon cycle. So we're going to take Niels, on his goose Akka, on a little tour of the carbon cycle. And that tour goes very far in space and very far in time. In fact, it starts some many, many, many thousands of light years away, and certainly much more than 5 billion years in the past. With a star, not our sun, but a large first-generation star, which was made out of the main substance that the universe is made out of, hydrogen. Almost all of the universe starts off as hydrogen. So this star cooked along for maybe 1 billion, 2 billion years, and as it cooked along, nuclear fusion cooked that hydrogen into heavier elements, everything up until iron. Elements heavy as iron, nothing heavier than iron, but that includes our all of these metals, and some of these like magnesium and calcium and aluminum will play a role in our story, and silicon. But the two big ones that will involve this story of climate and come back into the economy and Sweden's world leadership in energy policy: carbon and oxygen. Okay. Now, what happened then? Well, these large, massive stars don't live for very long. They only live for 1.5 billion years or so, maybe 2 billion years, which is a short time as reckoned by people who think in deep time. It exploded as a supernova, and that created heavier elements, including the things we rely on for nuclear energy, like uranium. But it also dispersed all that carbon, oxygen, all the things that we are made out of, into the rest of the galaxy, where some of it, about 4.5 billion years ago, condensed into the sun, and our planets. And without this previous star that died for us, we wouldn't be here, because you cannot make people, plants, and so forth out of hydrogen alone. And so Niels is able to go back and look at these things, and we are able to go back and look at these things that happened billions of years ago through the wonderful advances in geological science, many of which were made here, to allow us to read the record of the past in tiny bits of dust left behind that you can find in the Earth and in space today. And within a fairly quick time, that gas and dust condensed into the sun, the rocky parts turned into the planets like Earth and Mars and Venus, and the leftover hydrogen turned into Jupiter and Saturn farther out, and then here we are. So now, all that carbon and oxygen kind of cooked in the Earth's oven, and I'm going to tell you something about what has happened to all that carbon and oxygen since. But I first want to give you some feeling for one of the units you're going to hear a lot of, the gigaton, a gigaton of carbon. In English, we say billion tons. I think it would be milliard in Swedish. So does anybody know what mountains these are? Anybody recognize them? Geographers out there? I'll give you a hint. It's connected with Niels Holgersson. So this is the Akka. This is, in fact, the Akka Massivet. It's a place I love to hike. It's right at the beginning of the Padjelanta Leden. This is another one of the great Swedish innovations, the Hilleberg tent, which is the world's very best tent. And if you ever do go there and you don't stay in the Svenska Turistförening, I recommend you go get yourself a Hilleberg right away. So this is the Akka Massivet, the goose that little Niels rides around in is named after Akka, the Akka Massivet. One gigaton of carbon, if you piled it up, would look about like that. Okay, so that's our gigaton of carbon. So if you try to imagine the Akka and this one gigaton cone, that's the carbon, that will give you some idea of the kinds of quantities we're talking about, because we're going to see a lot of these gigatons. So now all that carbon that came and formed the Earth turned into various different substances that make up the Earth. Some of it winds up in the atmosphere, Some of it winds up in the interior of the Earth. In fact, most of the carbon wound up in the form of limestone, of calcareous rocks, calcium carbonate rocks. That's where most of our carbon is. Very little of it is in the form of organic carbon in forms like trees and us. But that carbon has not been just sitting there. It's been cycling through the Earth system for the whole 4 billion years of Earth history. And the basic cycle that's been going on, the basic natural carbon cycle, and what I want to come around to on this is what amount of carbon the basic natural global carbon cycle deals with, to put our own disruption of the carbon cycle in perspective. So the natural carbon cycle does something like this. Carbon dioxide in the air, that tiny bit of carbon dioxide in the air, combines with various kinds of rocks with silicon in them, I think feldspars, things like that. In the presence of water, that actually turns into limestone. It does not actually require life to happen. This was happening even before there was life on Earth. That limestone washes off the land, and it winds up being deposited on the floor of the sea. But because our planet has plate tectonics, because the continents are moving around and parts of the ocean floor are always being sucked down into the interior where it's hot, that gets cooked out. That gets cooked out. That limestone gets cooked out. And it turns, in the presence of sand, quartz, silicon dioxide, ordinary sand, basically, and various other kinds of silica minerals, it gets cooked out and turns back into carbon dioxide. In fact, if you've ever been in Gotland, the big cement works there, Store Ugens, they do exactly this. This is part of the process that's used in making cement, and the Store Ugens are there in Gotland partly because of the supply of calc there. To make cement, you go a little bit further. You actually make calcium oxide, but you actually release cement from the rocks in an artificial way in the process of making cement. That's not the main human source of carbon dioxide, but in any event, it's a closed cycle because the carbon dioxide that comes from cooking these rocks back together in the interior of the Earth leaks out through volcanoes, and that closes the cycle. This is a critical part of the cycle that over millions and billions of years naturally regulates our climate and keeps our Earth habitable. And the amount of carbon flowing through that system amounts to 12 gigatons of carbon, just 12 of those cones of carbon, 12 of those akas of carbon every 200 years. Okay? And I've put this in units of 200 years because that's roughly the length of the Industrial Revolutions so far, and we're going to get into what people have done to the carbon cycle. Once we came along and started industry. So this 12 gigatons has been ticking along. Now, there was actually before us, long before us, evolution produced a form of life that had a major disruptive effect on the carbon cycle, which then comes back into our story today. The Earth is roughly 4 billion years old. There's been life on Earth for about 3.5 billion years, but 2 billion years ago, evolution produced a really enormous innovation, which was photosynthesis. Photosynthesis. There was no oxygen in the atmosphere of the Earth, hardly any to speak of, 3 billion years ago. But about 2 billion years ago, somehow evolution produced green algae, cyanobacteria, blue-green algae, that had learned to use the energy in sunlight. It learned to use the energy in sunlight in a kind of solar nature's photocell, use the energy and sunlight to take carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and split it up, use it with water, and separate out the carbon and make organic carbon, just very much like the stuff you eat, and the black shales, coal, things like that, oils. It split off the carbon, made organic carbon, which then also sank to the bottom of the ocean and accumulated on the bottom of the ocean. And in the process of taking off that carbon, what's left is oxygen, O2, which is what we breathe. And oxygen is a very important energy source for life, and we couldn't have life with more than one cell. You couldn't have animals, plants, all the complex life that eventually led to us, and intelligent, if not necessarily wise, life. Forms of life that rely on oxygen as an energy carrier. And this cycle, this new innovation was such a huge perturbation, such a huge disruption of the carbon cycle that we think that it was one of the things that triggered a runaway ice house where the Earth froze over completely. And then gradually the Earth came into a new equilibrium where it was thawed out again. But it took many hundreds of millions of years to deal with this first innovation in the carbon cycle. Now this photosynthetic taking up of carbon dioxide is offset by the fact that oxygen is a very important energy carrier, and the combination of oxygen and organic carbon, which I've represented here as CH2O, that's carbohydrates. It's really not very different from bread. If you wrote a chemical formula for bread, it would basically be CH2O, carbon, and water hooked together in various longer, more complex forms. So the photosynthesis does this. It takes the energy of light, and it stores that solar energy by combining the carbon dioxide and water into organic carbon, releasing oxygen in the process. But life has had 2 billion years to get very, very good at what's called respiration, the process of basically burning. It's a slow burn that's done at body temperature. Life has gotten very good. It's had 2 billion years to learn how to find any organic carbon that's out there and recombine it with oxygen and release carbon dioxide. And this is respiration. This is what happens when we eat. So when you grow wood and burn it in a fire, when you grow a crop and then you eat it in the form of bread, you are using stored sunlight. You're using stored solar energy. But so even though photosynthesis was a huge disruption of the carbon cycle, in the end, once everything came back together and adjusted to this major biogeochemical innovation, in the end, it was all a wash. The books all balanced because almost every single bit, almost every scrap of that organic carbon that is made each year by photosynthesis, and that's maybe something like 100 gigatons, a huge amount of that is made each year. By photosynthesis, but almost every last scrap of that is turned back into CO2 the same year by respiration, by eating and this slow burning of the organic carbon. And so it almost balances out so that the net effect of photosynthesis and respiration is almost, but not quite. And the not quite is the really important part of our story where I'm going today, because a tiny bit of that carbon, a fraction of a percent of that organic carbon each year, will actually escape coming into contact with oxygen. It's only very special circumstances if you're in a swamp where you bury it under water that doesn't have oxygen in it, or if you go to certain parts of the deep ocean where the organic carbon gets buried by sediments and can't come in contact with oxygen, a tiny little bit of that organic carbon escapes being turned back into carbon dioxide. And at first, all of that tiny escaped amount of organic carbon was just in the ocean, because for about a billion years, the only life that was on Earth, for 2.5 billion years, if you go from the beginning of life, initially the only life on Earth was in the ocean. And so there was no photosynthesis on land. The only life was in the ocean, and the small bit of the carbon from ocean life that got into the sediments and escaped oxidation turned into oil. Okay, and some of that oil still exists today because some of the coastal regions escaped being sucked into the interior of the earth, and they exist in Saudi Arabia, in Oman, and places like that as oil deposits. And there were much more recent oil deposits as well. And then maybe 200 million years ago, a blink of an eye as geologists reckon time, there was another innovation. Plants evolved and were able to colonize the land. And a tiny trickle of that plant matter on land escaped being oxidized, and that turned into our coal. most of the economic, most of the fossil fuels on Earth are coal. Oil is a relatively small part of the total. It's really coal. If there's anything that is going to, that has the potential to turn the Earth into a practically uninhabitable place, it would be the coal deposits. Coal. Every fossil fuel releases CO2, carbon dioxide, when you burn it. But the big numbers, the thing that we most need to learn how to leave in the ground so as not to make our planet uninhabitable, the big numbers are in the coal on land. And then there's some of the natural gas formed by a variety of processes that further chemical alterations of this tiny trickle of organic carbon. Now we came along. We came along, and about 200 years ago, we started learning how to dig up the coal, like in that mine that Johan showed you in Svalbard. We learned how to, these deposits, which built up over millions and millions, or hundreds of millions of years in some cases, and had escaped being brought in contact with oxygen by any natural processes before humans, suddenly humans, with our intelligence and our technology, came along. We were able to actually tap into this organic carbon and tap into the hundreds of millions of years of stored sunlight, stored solar energy. And what we have done by doing this is maybe the biggest disruption in the carbon cycle, the biggest and fastest disruption in the carbon cycle that has ever been seen in all of Earth history. Particularly in terms of the rapidity of it. So remember our gigatons. One gigaton is the size of the right one bit of the Aka Massif. At the present rate at which we're using fossil fuels, over 200 years total, we will have put between 1,000 and 5,000 gigatons of carbon into the atmosphere. So think of this number, 12. 12 is what the natural carbon cycle has been dealing with for billions of years. Suddenly, 12 for 200 years is what the natural carbon cycle has been doing. We are doing 1,000 to 5,000 for 200 years. The 1,000 is where we will go if we really very aggressive. If all the world does what Sweden has done with its carbon outputs, we may stop using fossil fuels at about the time we hit a total emission of 1,000 gigatons of carbon, 1 trillion tons of carbon. But if we burn all the coal that's likely to be out there, if we continue our exponential growth in the use of fossil fuels, as the world is doing, most of the world is doing, then we will have put actually 5,000. But even 1,000 in a 200-year period is an absolutely enormous disruption of the carbon cycle relative to the natural climate regulating process that has been going on for billions of years. So some people say, you know, that humans are too small to affect something as big as the Earth, but in fact, it's a vast understatement that say humans are a force of geological proportions. Compared to geology, we are so big in our imprint on the Earth, it makes geology look unimportant, except to those of us who get paid to do it, which looks very important. And we're very grateful to be paid to do such an interesting thing and hope that some of the insights we have come back to society in terms of things that will help keep this wonderful Earth a habitable place for our future generations. But this is a huge disruption of the carbon cycle. And we can measure the human imprint on the carbon cycle by numbers like this, 1,000 and 5,000 gigatons. That, if you try to imagine, there's really only one number you have to keep in mind if you want to understand how the fossil fuel era will reset the climate for the rest of the history of humanity, probably the rest of the history of the human species in the future. And that's the cumulative carbon. We have to stop emitting carbon eventually. Now, maybe we'll do that because the fossil fuels just run out, and we go all the way to 5,000 gigatons, or maybe even more, if some estimates are right. Maybe we go to 5,000 before we stop using fossil fuels. But maybe we will be very, very good, and we will stop using fossil fuels at about the time we emit 1,000 gigatons. That number, which is the total amount of carbon we emit by burning fossil fuels, up to the time when we stop using them. That's called cumulative carbon. You can add it up year by year. So that's the definition of cumulative carbon. It's not the amount of carbon in gigatons that you emit each year. It's you add up each year's new amount of emissions and get the total amount that has been emitted to date. And some of that stays in the atmosphere. A lot of it stays in the atmosphere and makes a problem for climate. So cumulative carbon is the sum of all carbon released as carbon dioxide by human activities since the beginning of our disruption of the carbon cycle by burning fossil fuels. So this just gives you an example how cumulative carbon is defined. So let's say that the emissions, the amount each year that is emitted into the atmosphere in the form of carbon dioxide by burning fossil fuels, coal, oil, natural gas. Let's say we emit 10 gigatons each year. And that's actually pretty close. That's only a little bit more than the current world emissions. The current world emissions are about 9 gigatons a year. So that's like 9 mountains the size of Akka that are being dumped into the carbon system each year through burning fossil fuels. But so if we have 10 gigatons each year, 10 gigatons of carbon each year, then our cumulative carbon in the first year is 10 gigatons. But in the second year, we add up the first year plus the second year's new emission, we get 20 gigatons of cumulative carbon. And in the third year, we have another 10 gigatons added to the pile. The pile keeps growing, 30 gigatons of carbon. So that's the cumulative amount of carbon that has been added to the Earth system. And if you do what we're doing now, which is roughly 10 gigatons a year for 100 years, you get 1,000 gigatons dumped into the carbon system that the Earth atmosphere system has to deal with. Right now, we're emitting about 10 gigatons a year right now, but the problem is that the world as a whole is not just emitting a fixed amount. The amount that we are emitting is growing exponentially. So in fact, it really takes much less than 100 years. It only takes about 30 years to add another trillion tons of carbon to the Earth system if the world does not get off the exponential growth curve that we're on right now. A lot of that carbon stays in the atmosphere, this is a graph. And natural processes remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere very, very slowly. So this is a graph of what the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The numbers here don't matter too much. This is a measure of the amount of carbon dioxide that's actually in the atmosphere, because it's the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that traps heat and causes the planet to warm up more. This is the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere versus time. This is the year 2000. That's the year 7000. It's hard to get politicians to think about the year 7000, but this is what we're doing. This is what we have to learn how to think about. These curves are what the future of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere looks like relative to the natural pre-industrial level, which is this blue line, out to the year 7000, as a function of how much cumulative carbon we emit. So the red line is 1 trillion tons, and this is roughly double. And with 1 trillion tons, you don't quite double the natural amount. With 3 trillion tons, you come up to here, tripling the natural amount. And with 5 trillion tons, you come up to here, you more than quadruple the natural amount. But the thing is that if you go out to the year 7000, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere still hasn't come anywhere close to the natural level. We are sort of from the standpoint of the timescales of human societies, and we've had civilization for maybe 8,000 or 10,000, 8,000 years or so, or settled urban civilization, agricultural civilization for maybe 6,000 years, we are permanently altering, we're creating a new geological era. And there's a simple relationship between cumulative carbon and the amount of climate change, that 1,000 of these gigatons translates into a 2-degree warming of the Earth. And it just adds up. So if we do 1,000 gigatons before we quit fossil fuels, before we kick the fossil fuel habit, we'll warm the Earth by 2 degrees. And it will stay 2 degrees warmer for basically thousands of years. If we go to 5,000 gigatons, it'll be 10 degrees. And that's just the global average. And land warms more than the ocean. The polar regions warm more than the mid-latitudes. And so 5 gigatons translates into a truly alarming amount of warming, a truly fatal amount of warming for a large parts of the Earth, especially the tropics. And the alarming thing, so 1,000 gigatons takes us to 2 degrees of warming, which is already a threshold where a lot of bad things start to happen, and we are halfway there already. We've emitted half of this 1,000 gigaton allotment. So you can think of 1,000 gigatons as a kind of an allowable target. It's a target of how much you can emit before stopping if you accept 2 degrees as the maximum warming you will tolerate. And we're halfway there already. So one way of looking at climate justice, one way of turning this into climate justice is to, before I talk about climate justice, let me just give you another picture about how this disruption of the carbon cycle essentially creates a new geological era called the Anthropocene, the period of time when humans set most of the features of the climate and overwhelmed geology. So let's just look at the temperature. This is from 20,000 years in the past when there was the last ice age. This is how the temperature has varied. This is the Holocene, which was the era that civilization arose in, 10,000 years long. So this is 10,000 years ago. This is roughly now. During the Holocene, temperature varied very, very little. It's been on a slight cooling trend over the last 10,000 years from changes in the Earth's orbit. And then this is what a future geologist will see in the ice core record, if there's any ice left to look at. Given various amounts of cumulative carbon from this is 1,000 gigatons out to 5,000 gigatons. This goes out to the year 10,000 in the future. To a future geologist, even 1,000 gigatons will look like an event as big as the last ice age, but in the opposite direction. If we go to 5,000 gigatons, you have to go tens and tens of millions of years back to find anything comparable, and the thing that is comparable is not nearly as fast. So we are basically creating a new era, but the index, the thermostat dial that says how big of a geological event the Anthropocene is going to be is this number, cumulative carbon. So you can now divide up, and we start to get into the economics. You can actually try to take this 500 gigatons that's left that we can emit before crossing a 2 degrees threshold and try to divide it up equally among the world population and see what a fair share of carbon would actually be and how close various countries are to how long countries can emit at their current rate without using up their remaining fair share. But so first I should say, why should Swedish emissions matter? Because the world emissions of carbon are about 9 gigatons. That's the whole world. That's the stack here. This little blue krona down here, even that's a slight exaggeration of what the Swedish annual emissions are, 0.014 gigatons of carbon. So if you do the comparison this way, it looks like you could say, well, it just doesn't matter whether Sweden has no carbon or doubles or triples carbon. It's a small part of the total. But the thing is that you could always make a big problem look trivial if you divide it up into a lot of small pieces and say each of those pieces is trivial. What if you divide up the whole world into countries with population the size of Sweden, and then you say, well, each one has a trivial contribution to the total, so nobody has the responsibility to go. But in fact, every actor has a responsibility. But beyond that, there's a way that I will get to very soon, a very important way that Sweden can help bring down the rest of the world's carbon by showing the way to how to do it. So the ultimate thing in terms of individual responsibility is to look at carbon emissions per person. And so again, as an American, I have no right really to talk to Sweden about carbon emissions, except that I hope to use Sweden as an example in the US of what should be happening in the United States. I have to use that in China as well as an example. So the per person carbon emissions, now these are a new unit, a brick, one ton of carbon, 1 metric ton of carbon, 1,000 kilograms. This desk here, this lectern, if you made it out of carbon, this would be roughly 1 ton of carbon. So if you think about someone, if your personal use is 1 ton of carbon per year, then you can imagine someone delivering one of these to you each year and saying, "Where do you want me to put it?" Okay, and then I already have problems finding places to keep my books at home. And as an American, someone would be delivering five of these each and every year and saying, okay, where do you want me to put it? And I say, I don't want you to put it anywhere. Take it away. But you can't because it's in the Earth system. And you have that responsibility for it. You're stuck with it. Okay, so in the U.S. per person, we emit about 5 tons, 5 metric tons. Sweden is at 1.5 metric tons. And it's very interesting that actually Sweden and France are quite similar. Very low per person carbon emissions compared to other developed countries. But what's really interesting is that actually the per capita emissions in either Sweden or France are now higher somewhat, are now somewhat lower than the Chinese per capita emissions. India is still down here at about 0.5 metric ton per person. But it becomes even more interesting to look at how this compares with the size of the various economies. Because in the end, we don't live for emitting carbon. We live to live well. We live to have time with our children, our neighbors, hiking in these beautiful places, going to the opera, going to Fasching and jazz clubs, and all sorts of things. Although gross national income is only a crude measure of how well you live, it gives some measure of what your capabilities are. When you look at the fair share, and then we look at how our usage of the fair share of carbon stacks up against how well we use it to provide a good life for our people, things look a little bit different. So to give you an idea of the fair share, if you divide up the 500 gigatons of remaining carbon that the world as a whole can emit before breaching 2 degrees, before crossing 2 degrees, that fair share amounts to 67 tons of carbon per person. So each of us, worldwide, has a kind of entitlement to emit 67 more tons if we forget about the past, which is problematic. We shouldn't really forget about the past. But even if we forget about the past, we have a right to emit individually an equal right, assuming all humans are equal in their rights. We have a right to emit 67 tons per person. And even in Sweden, at the current rate of Swedish emissions, that's only 44 more years. Which means that even at the Swedish rate of emissions, you have to get down to zero emissions in 44 years if you're going to do the fair thing. In the United States, this amounts to something like 10 years of emissions. The US has to get down from 5 tons per person per year down to zero in 10 years if we're going to do the fair thing. To do the fair thing, you basically have to use your energy more efficiently, and this comes back to the second reason that Swedish emissions matter. In my experience, the main barrier to action, in the American context particularly, the main barrier to action on reducing emissions is not that people are insufficiently afraid of the dangers of climate change, especially among American Republicans. It's not that people are insufficiently afraid of how bad it's going to get. So no amount of explaining science to Republicans actually helps change their mind, because the real barrier is a fear, at least among conservatives worldwide, but particularly in the United States. The real barrier is a fear about the nature of the policies that are needed to address the problem. You get all sorts of conflation of mixing up of the nature of the problem with the nature of the solution, where in fact there are free market approaches to reducing carbon emissions. It does not necessarily mean the government taking over the economy. And here, Sweden has a very important role as an example. Because now when you look at the per person national income in these various countries, you can see that actually you can live well. You can be very prosperous without emitting so much carbon. And so this is current dollar national income per person in 2010. I didn't translate this into purchasing power parity because there are a lot of economic questions about just how you do that to say what a dollar is worth in different countries. For example, you know, I buy a lot of Kalles caviar here. Kalles caviar is much cheaper here than it is in Chicago, where I have to go to Andersonville and pay 5 times the price. But so my personal basket, actually, that purchasing power parity of a dollar, if I'm putting it into Kalles caviar, is different. And there are other things like fjällräddning and Loi Rom and so forth. How do you compare? It has to be done, but it's hard to do. But so these are exchange rate dollars. But Sweden actually comes in at very slightly higher than the U.S. on this, despite having much lower. Despite having much lower carbon emissions. France comes in pretty well too in terms of national income. But it's interesting, although China is now emitting more per person than Sweden, China has a tiny per capita national income compared to Sweden. There are problems in comparing national income among different kinds of economies, but certainly the lesson from this is that China could become as rich as Sweden, as prosperous as Sweden, pull itself out of poverty without increasing its emissions at all if it only used its carbon allotment as efficiently as Sweden does. And that's the big lesson here. And in fact, I'm coming towards the end of this now. Here on this graph, I show that economic growth and emissions reduction can go together. We always hear in the American debates that, global warming is a problem, but we can't afford to experiment with the economy. We can't afford to impoverish ourselves to solve the problem. But in fact, Sweden has done that experiment with the economy for the rest of the world. And the outcome is actually really good. That outcome of using carbon more efficiently actually seems to be pretty good. Because here, actually, this is per capita carbon emissions going back to 1950. And actually, the big drop in per capita emissions came from energy policy in the 70s, which were not primarily environmental, but a response to the energy crisis and the need for more energy independence. But then that drop continued as environmental policy started to come in around 1980, roughly when Bert Bolin was getting involved in the international dimension of climate change. Now, this is the Swedish per capita gross national income. And this now is corrected for purchasing power parity, so it's got inflation taken into account. And so over the years from 1990, when the environmental policy started to kick in, to now when we really have quite low per capita emissions, the economy has just been booming along. And what's more, everyone and a lot of conservatives worldwide are afraid of a carbon tax. But correlation doesn't mean causation. But if you were going to draw any lesson naively from a graph like that, you would say, well, a carbon tax is terrific for the economy because just when this wonderful growth took off, then that was about the time when the first carbon tax was introduced, which was $100 a ton carbon, which is enormous compared to anything that's being talked about anyplace else in the world. And what's more, that carbon tax, although there are exemptions for certain sectors, that carbon tax has increased to by a factor of five, and the economy has boomed along. And I was happy to hear that some of the exemptions on the carbon tax for some industry sectors are being lifted gradually. I think that's a very good development. And so economic growth is compatible with carbon emissions and with carbon emissions reduction. And how did this miracle happen? Well, first of all, in a modern economy, energy is a rather small share of what we do. What we mostly sell is information now, not actual stuff that requires lots of energy to make, and the stuff we do make needs less and less energy to make all the time. So that's part, that applies to every place in the world, really. But there's a lot of specific Swedish technological innovations that have been deployed, a whole lot of different solutions. This is Hamnhuset I Göteborg, which is so well insulated, it requires zero external energy input to heat it. In fact, there's so much extra heat generated in Centralen here in Stockholm that they actually are talking about tapping it to heat the surrounding building, just the heat from energy usage and people going through can be tapped and used to heat other buildings because they have excess heat in a big public place. So there are innovations like that. You have most of the heating in Sweden is done through fjärrvärme, a district warming, and much of that is fueled by biofuels, burning garbage, biogas, and so forth. This is a Swedish company that makes a very good electric heat pump that uses electricity for heating much more efficiently. That can be sold to the other countries and contribute to the gross national income. Geothermal heat storage systems, which tap into the moderate temperatures deeper in the earth to use energy more efficiently. They work well with heat pumps. Hydropower has long been a very important part. This is the Svorva Dam, which is one of the earliest dams built in Sweden for hydropower. There's a great deal of hydropower. That's about 25% of the story of Sweden's low emissions. But also, I risk being a little bit controversial here, is Sweden has preserved its existing nuclear power. It hasn't expanded its existing nuclear power, but the base load provided by existing nuclear power is quite important. And I think Germany was rather foolish in deciding to shut down its nuclear power on an emergency basis practically, because it just meant they've had to burn more coal. And maybe someday you can replace this nuclear power with something else. That would probably be a good thing. But until you actually know what to replace it with, to shut it down would be foolish. And if you also, hydropower, although it's very good for carbon, is not really very good for the environment, generally speaking. When the Porjus Dam was put together, it actually destroyed the ecosystem in the whole Långas Valley here. This is near Sarek. So if you didn't have this, you would need more of this, which would not be a good thing for the environment either. But there are other things. There's wind power. We all love wind power. You can have lots and lots more of it. And a lot of biofuels are being used in Sweden. But it's still necessary in that next 60 years or so, or even 30 years, to get down to zero carbon. And this is where Sweden can lead the way. What's left, that the source of the problem are this stuff, cars and transport, because almost all of the remaining carbon emissions in Sweden come from liquid fuels. This graph shows the annual emissions in megatons of carbon, million tons of carbon by year, but broken down into different components. So the black line is the total. The red line is liquid fuels, which is basically oil and gas, mostly oil and liquid gas, gasoline. And you can see that, although actually there's been this curious uptick in the use of solid fuels, probably peat in industrial applications, that should be gotten down to zero. Almost all of the remaining Swedish carbon emissions are transport, fuel, forestry, and so forth. And that's what you have to get down to zero. That's the next frontier in Swedish carbon policy. If you want to build the world's first modern economy that is carbon-free. At one point, the government had a commitment, had taken on a commitment to have zero transport carbon in 30 years, or maybe it was 20 years. That has been relaxed, but I would very much hope to see that commitment come back in at some point. Perhaps we'll hear about that in the panel discussion. So I want to end with another one of my favorite books, Swedish novels, or series, actually. Five, I think there are five of them, by Per Anders Fogelström, the Stad series, starting with Mina Drömmerstad. This is not just the story of a family in Stockholm, but it's really the story of an earlier revolution in which Sweden led the way. It's the story of the building of the Folkhemmet. It was Sweden showing the way that economic justice could coexist with democracy and capitalism. And this was a very different development than happened in much of the rest of the world. And in 30 years, if someone writes another set of novels like this, I hope it will be about how Sweden led the world forward into a carbon dioxide-free future. Thank you.
So thank you, Ray. There is now still a little bit of time left for questions, and there will be microphones walking around in the room. So you raise your hand, you will get a microphone, and everyone can hear you. And while they're getting organized, I want to start by asking a question myself. So this time frame that you elaborate on is really quite staggering.
Yeah.
And yet only a couple of decades ago, when this was discussed in the public, you got the impression that, yes, carbon dioxide was long-lived, but people were talking about hundreds or maybe 200, yeah. In the worst case, 300 years.
Yeah.
So would you comment on that? I mean, could you kill that?
You often heard people say, well, carbon dioxide, or policymakers, even some scientists say carbon dioxide lives in the atmosphere for centuries, which just understates the case. And that actually came from really a misunderstanding of things that had been known since Bert Bolin wrote his thesis. It came from thinking that everything has just one time scale. And in fact, carbon dioxide is removed slowly by multiple processes, some of which are fairly fast, but then you use up those fast processes fast, and quickly. And then there's this long tail that goes off into the future. And if you want to read about this in a very accessible, popular book, my colleague David Archer has written a book called The Long Thaw, about basically what was in Bert Bolin's thesis.
So we can kill that notion. Sure, yeah.
And for the first, the IPCC sometimes has been a little bit confusing in the way it discussed this, but I was very happy to see in AR5, the most recent IPCC report, that in fact the statement about the long-lived effect of carbon dioxide has finally been made very clearly.
So we have a question over there.
Tipping point.
Yeah, it's on.
This always happens.
Is there a tipping point, a point when we can't go back and the environment can't recover?
Well, so this is an interesting question. So one often hears about tipping points. That is a situation where if you cross a certain amount of carbon in the system or a certain temperature, then even if you somehow cool the Earth down again, then you wouldn't come back. So, for example, it's possible that once you cross a certain point, you commit the Greenland ice cap to melt, and even if you were to somehow suck CO2 out of the atmosphere, then you wouldn't be able to solve the problem. We don't know where these tipping points actually are. There are a lot of possibilities in terms of forests dying off, ice, things like that happening, carbon releases from the soil, things like that. What we do know about the tipping points is that the hotter we make it, the more cumulative carbon we put into the system, and the more we go out of this known operating range in the past 10,000 years, the more likely we are to encounter tipping points. And in fact, this whole question of planetary boundaries is another thing that has been pioneered in Stockholm at the Resilience Center, which has a close connection with the university, because it's not just through the carbon cycle, it's all the other biogeochemical cycles that human activities are disrupting. And so we can't say where those tipping points are, but even without tipping points, things could get really very bad. But the more we disrupt these natural systems, the more likely we are to encounter a tipping point.
So we have a question over here. Oh, okay,
yeah, one. Yes, my name is Fred Goldberg, Swedish Polar Institute. We are talking about carbon dioxide being a heat source because of energy absorption, right? But when we are dealing with these absorption processes, we also have a saturation effect.
No, actually, this was an interesting fallacy that played out right here in Sweden very early on, where, in fact, another Swede, Angström, the younger Angström, had criticized Arrhenius, saying that after you have a certain amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it didn't matter anymore. It didn't have a warming effect because you use up all the absorbing capability. That happened within 30, that criticism came out within a few decades after Arrhenius. But it was based on bad physics, incorrect spectroscopy, and incorrect understanding of the way carbon dioxide absorbs, and incorrect laboratory experiments. And so that idea of a saturation effect was considered and discarded about 100 years ago. And although it keeps being repeated, it's completely fallacious.
Well, then you could perhaps
next one in here. Over there?
Yeah. I should mention while we're waiting, the third Angström, they were like the Trapp family singers of electromagnetic radiation. The third Angström actually played a big role in the founding of the Swedish Weather Service. So,
I'm trying to get as many questions in as possible. So we have one over here.
Yep. Thank you very much for a very inspiring lecture. You mentioned the IPCC reports. Do you think we now know enough about justice, fairness, and equity for the negotiator in Paris to reach a just climate deal?
Yeah, we know what needs to be done. We know we need to get down to zero emissions before we go much past 1,000 gigatons. The essential problem with justice that will be difficult to work out in Paris is that countries like the United States have already used more than their fair share of carbon in past emissions, whereas China has probably another 50 years to go before they've used up what would be a fair allocation of their total share of this trillion tons worldwide. So if for there to be real justice, the United States and to a lesser extent Europe would have to pay India and China and Africa for the carbon that they don't emit. The size of that transfer is enormous and it's not going to happen. But instead, given that China and India have a stake in not being made uninhabitable, the way that the more developed world can help those countries with the technology needed to bring down their carbon emissions is the way I see this happening.
So we have one question up there, and then we have a gentleman over there.
Yeah, hi. Göran Drell, studying sustainable urban planning at KTH.
Where are you? I like to see who I...
Here I am.
Oh, there. Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Reassure me. You showed that like 1,000 would be 2 degrees, and you said that 5 times that would be 10 degrees.
That's right.
Is that a linear?
Yes, this is a remarkable thing. This is a remarkable thing that that there are two nonlinearities in the climate system that cancel out each other, so that the warming is basically linearly proportional to the amount of cumulative carbon that you release.
Okay, thank you.
You know.
Over there.
Hello, I'm Richard Stone from this university.
No.
And in environmental science, and environmentalists usually don't like nuclear, and it's very controversial here. But with studies, you could say it's quite clean. So would you say it's... we talked about hydrogen and nuclear. Would you say nuclear might be a positive...
Well,
evolution?
Actually, a lot of environmentalists, environmental organizations are now coming out in favor of some role of nuclear power in the mix, just because the magnitude of the problem of getting down carbon emissions to zero is so huge that starting from where we are now, it's very hard to imagine a future worldwide, at least, where nuclear power doesn't play a role. None of us really like it. There's a problem with nuclear. Waste storage. There's not much problem with safe operation of reactors. France shows that. And I would say if we had started 30 years ago on this process, we probably could do this without nuclear. But we've delayed so long as a world that right now the only technology that can really close the gap, I think, is nuclear. And not every country will have the same mix. So Sweden has more hydropower, China has less. China and India would have to use more nuclear than is in the Swedish mix. The other thing, nuclear is not great, but if it's nuclear versus coal, nuclear actually has fewer environmental issues than continued burning of coal.
So we have one question over there, and then we have, I think there was someone waving down here. Over there, yeah. So over there and then there.
Hello, thank you very much for a great presentation. My name is Magnus, and I would like to ask you, how do we reach out to the people, to the individuals, and actually make them go green? Thanks.
Well, one thing, there are several different ways of reaching people. Now, of course, there are some things that can be done by individual choice. There's some things that require a collective action. And so Bill McKibben in the U.S. likes to say that your first action is to screw in a new light bulb that uses less energy. Your second action is to screw in a new senator. Until we actually, in much of the world, this doesn't apply in Sweden so much, but this applies in the US, which is a bigger emitter. We do need change at the top as well. But there are two ways to generate grassroots, bottom-up enthusiasm for carbon reduction. One is through, and I've been talking to both of these groups. One is through the churches, the religious organization, which reach a lot of people. who want to reduce carbon emissions because it's the right thing to do. It's ethically, it's morally right. The other is through the business community. Lots of the business community actually sees carbon emission as a business opportunity. And I've been talking to them too. In fact, I have an appointment with the Archbishop here who is actually leading the Svenska Kyrkan into further into its advocacy for environmental protection. In fact, she came from a seminary in Chicago in Hyde Park, where I used to live, and had done many of the same things with the ministry of the Lutheran School of Theology there. So those are two ways. Those are two ways to do
it. So we're slowly running out of time, so I'm going to allow two more questions. There's one in the back and one in the front, and keep it snappy, and that goes for you too, Ray.
Yeah, I'll try to keep it snappy too, yeah.
Hello? Oh.
Yeah. Hello.
My name is Carolina, and I wondered that when you showed how the natural process removes the carbon dioxide, the more that was in the air, like when it was about 5 trillion tons, mm-hmm. The process was much faster than when it was only 1 trillion. So I wonder what that depends on.
Yes, actually, this gets back to this question of there being multiple timescales for the removal. And so the initial stage of removal is where involves the sucking of carbon into the upper part of the ocean, and also land uptake of carbon by trees growing faster and things like that. And that lasts for maybe 50 years or so. So when you put more carbon into the air, in this particular set of climate simulations, that those initial fast processes do get a little bit faster. But what also happens, though, is that the amount that's left over into the atmosphere, the proportion that stays in the atmosphere, also gets larger. And so although there is an appearance, to some extent correct, of the first stage of that carbon removal getting faster, it comes at the expense of using it up faster, and then this fat tail being fatter and fatter, being higher and higher.
And the final question.
Does this work? Yeah. You mentioned that transportation was one of the greatest sources of carbon dioxide
emissions. Yes.
Yeah, emissions. Yeah.
It's slap.
And I was thinking about. I think it was last year when President Obama visited Sweden and Stockholm was all closed down for cars and people noticed directly that the air became much cleaner.
Yeah.
Do you think, or what effects could it have if we would just stop using cars in inner cities?
Yeah, well, actually, people do need to get around. And so the lesson isn't to just stop using cars, but it's to fuel them with carbon-free energy. And some of that could be biofuel, some of that could be electricity. There could be more public transportation in various places. And so I don't think a viable solution is just to move around less. But for example, if you have a choice between taking a train to get to Kiruna or to get to Abisko for your ski holiday versus driving there, or flying. Flying uses a lot of energy, and it's fossil fuel energy. Then these alternates that are carbon-free are much better. So in all of these cases, it's not so much a matter of doing without, it's a matter of using the energy more intelligently. And actually, in terms of the economic incentives, it is strange. I've done this several different times. I go up to Abisko a lot. I love that area. It's still true that it is strangely cheap to fly domestically. I have not really analyzed exactly why that is, why the carbon tax has not made air transport more expensive. Maybe one of the economists or also can tell us about that. But it should be much cheaper to take the train, even if you get a Ligvagen, than to fly. But in fact, it's kind of even with a Ligvagen, and more if you get the Sovagen. So,
okay, everyone. Thank you very much for the questions. There will be. You will get a second chance when we open up the panel discussion for public questions. But I would like now at this time to invite the panel up. And we're very happy to have Åsa Romson here. I don't think you really need an introduction. Everyone knows who you are. But anyway, spokesperson for the Green Party, Minister for the Environment, and also Vice Prime Minister. Also a Member of Parliament since 2010. I saw in Wikipedia that you were actually elected in 2006, but you turned it down for a PhD position at Stockholm University. So that's talk about devotion. Also a PhD in law with an environmental twist. We have Per Krusell. He was a professor of economics here at Stockholm University, researching on macroeconomics broadly, and is currently pursuing a project on the interaction between economy and the global climate. And we're going to get back to your debate article in a short while. And then we have Karin Bäckstrand, a professor of environmental social science, which is a new thing, at the Department of Political Science, and primary research around environmental politics, role of science in environmental decision-making, et cetera, et cetera. And then, of course, Ray is also on the panel. So we have four persons. And I wanted to start by asking each of you a specific question within your sort of area of competence, where you can elaborate a little. And also, I'd like to say that each and every one of you are welcome to interrupt the others and have a discussion between you. But before we go there, I wanted to ask you a yes or no question. So we have climate conference coming up in Paris, and everyone's talking about whether we will do it or not. So do you believe that we will come to a useful climate agreement in Paris, or do you not believe that? Per first.
No.
Yes.
Ray?
If I'm limited to yes or no, yes. I would say yes. Yes.
And also?
A useful yes, but an ultimate goal, no.
But that was more than yes or no. But you're a politician, so I excuse you.
You phrased it useful, and therefore I say yes. But yeah. Let's come back to what is useful.
Well,
and
you're
what
a politician, so you're excused.
It's actually going to happen, yeah.
So getting to the questions that I've been thinking about, I wanted to ask also something not so politic. Everything we're dealing with in climate negotiations has its basis in the science of climate science. So would you feel that there is a need for more climate science? Does it make a difference that we know more today than we did 10 years ago? And does it have an impact? Or phrasing it differently, has IPCC come to an end? Can it do any more? Is there other things that influences than science?
Well, science can always do more, and it need to do more. And without climate science, we wouldn't have any climate convention at all. I think it's very clear from the history, not from also from the science from this university, that we have actually formed an international dialogue. It's not an ultimate one. It's not the best of dialogues, but it isn't a global dialogue, and it only exists because of climate science and the knowledge and the fear, the global fear for these changes. But I think, and I see clearly that, as Raymond also pointed at, what is the problem for the politicians in the process is, of course, that it is not barely enough with the climate science. You need to have all the economic science, you need to have all the behavior science, and you need to know all the tools and which tools to use and what you could actually bring. So I think IPCC has a role also in the future, but what we saw with the latest report is that, at least in the Swedish media, it was much more focused on the part of the report that actually covered the more social part, because that is actually what is the crucial point. I think there is a lot more to know about carbon dioxide, but let's say it, as politicians, we don't need to know much more than we need to stop within 50 years, because that is what the time frame from any public or private investments in our society today is 50 years. If we need to build everything, we start building today for a society that is fossil free, then we need to rethink our policies already today. And we need help with that. And I think the IPCC and other science can do more there.
So that leads automatically into PAR, I think. You wrote a debate paper in Dagens Nyheter a while ago where you argued that the system is flawed, that the climate negotiations have to be done differently. So could you shortly elaborate on what you would like to see instead?
Yes, I answered no to the question also. So I think there's too much wishful thinking in these meetings. I think the current approach for a while has been to try to agree on emitting a maximum amount of carbon. And I understand it's very intuitive, and I thought your way of making it clear was fantastic. But the problem is, I mean, you have to imagine these world leaders of all these countries sitting down, agreeing on restricting themselves, and then they have to agree how much each and every one of them has to be restricted. So it's like we're thinking about limiting the number of cars driving through downtown Stockholm. In Sweden and in London and other places, we do it now in a variety of ways, but one way is to use a tax. It's a road toll that you pay every time you pass. And that doesn't restrict anyone from not going, but you pay a price, and that really affects people's behavior. So we have to imagine the current system is really like, think of the different parts of Stockholm, like the boroughs, like Älvsjö, Nacka, each and everyone being represented by one politician. So you could think of Putin in Älvsjö, President Xi of China, he's in Nacka, Obama is in Danderyd maybe, and Cameron is, I don't know, we can go on. People live in Ekerö as well. And they have to sit down, and now they don't particularly like each other either. They have to decide for the next 25 years how many trips to make. And they have to agree on, I can make this many trips. And the problem is, you don't know how many trips you're going to need to make downtown, and you're just very reluctant to agree on anything. So it's like the worst case of a zero-sum game. But if you can agree instead on a price to pay every time you use it and set that price high enough, then that leads to the same outcome. A price, getting back to the behavioral way of thinking, I mean, a price on this bad thing. I mean, we cause damage by using cars and by using fossil fuel. So if we pay a higher price for doing it, that's going to refrain us from doing it. And that will be enough. I mean, we'll lead to the development of alternatives. It will kill the coal industry. So I think we have to switch. We can't be hoping that the EU agree on a cap and trade system. We're so great. It doesn't work in the world as a whole. So I think we have to switch to a carbon tax.
So this actually turns quite interesting from science to economics influencing behavior. So, yep. So the next question obviously goes to Karin. And when I've been out debating climate in various venues or in media or other places, my impression is that the NGOs, the organizations like Naturskyddsföreningen and other organizations like that, they're much more into understanding the problem, and they also have a lot of solutions. So what is the role of these organizations in influencing the global negotiations in a positive way? Do they have a role, or are they just making noise and nothing happens?
That's a very important question. I would say civil society or non-state actors more broadly, and that includes industry, play a very significant role. Now, in Lima, there were around 12,000 participants in the negotiations. Around 5,000 were observers. They don't have influence in that sense that they are not among the 194 states deciding. But they play a very important role, like civil society in national politics, of advocacy and awareness raising. They actually are used, many civil society sit actually on the national delegations, help advance text. But I would say one of the most important functions of civil society and non-state actors, it's being that watchdog over if in the implementation phase, do actually states deliver and comply. And now, especially with the forthcoming agreement in Paris. Yes, I think there would be an agreement, and I think it's good. And I will do a defense later on for the UN process. But in that, with regard to these pledges that states will do now, NGOs, civil society, and the research community will have a very important role to see, are they sufficient? Do the states deliver so we can keep within the 2 degrees goal? So, and then one more function of civil society, I think, is actually the question of legitimacy. Now at the negotiations tables, we have 195 states. Many of them are not democracies. So civil society can be a kind of transmitter of public interest and citizens. They are kind of, even if it's debated, are NGOs legitimate because they are not elected, but still they can represent a public conscience, and I think that's very important.
So final question then goes to Ray, and I think I know what you're going to answer, but I still want to hear you answer that to the public. What about climate engineering? Isn't there a technical way we could just reduce the solar radiation or absorb the carbon dioxide artificially, or doing something with a system that we're smart, right? Yeah. So we should be able to figure something out. Is that a solution if everything else fails? Is there a point where we have to do it?
Yeah, so this is the subject of the National Research Council report that was just released yesterday, and there's been a whole lot of press coverage of this. Actually, the current wave of interest in what's sometimes called geoengineering was launched by Paul Crutzen, who has an affiliation, a history of this department with this university, which he said in a rather innocuous little editorial in a climate journal that, well, it looks like we're not doing anything about carbon emissions. Maybe we need to think about a plan B. And, well, volcanoes cool down the climate by emitting things that reflect sunlight. Why don't we just do some of that? He wasn't actually advocating it. It was just, I've heard Paul do these sort of things. Oh, what?
But this it's become a big thing, right?
Yeah, but that launched a lot of research, serious thinking in the scientific community about these techniques. And there are two techniques. One is for sucking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere faster than natural processes. That's called carbon dioxide capture. The other thing is called albedo modification, which is squirting sulfur dioxide into the stratosphere and things like that to try to reflect more sunlight. These are two very different things. And one way of summing up the situation is that there are cheap and effective ways of engineering the climate. There are cheap and effective and safe ways of engineering the climate, but the ones that are cheap are not safe, and ones that are safe are not cheap. You don't have the combination. And so carbon dioxide removal would be effective if we could do it, but it's too expensive with current technology. But still merits research to try to learn how to do it, because it would be a game changer. But the other thing, albedo modification, I'll put it this way. I just published an article in Slate magazine in which I described this idea, even though I'm an author on the report, described this idea as the English word, barking mad, helt galen. I don't even know what the Swedish word would be for barking mad. It's a particular kind of extreme lunacy.
Bild galen,
galen. Yeah, it's completely crazy because you are taking something that you're taking a climate forcing like CO2. That will change the climate for the next 10,000 years, and you're trying to cancel it out with something that you have to renew every single year because these stratospheric aerosols go away after about a year or two. When, as a society, have we ever managed to keep our attention on something for 10,000 years? There's no precedent for this. A lot can happen in 10,000 years. So it's to actually commit the future to keeping the Earth cool by doing something highly technological and organized, and even agreeing on what the world's thermostat setting ought to be. It's completely crazy.
So does also have as a politician, is this anything that is even discussed in the negotiations? Does Sweden have a policy?
Engineering is not discussed in the climate negotiations, and I think I agree with Per that a complementary discussion on the global level or I would welcome a discussion on European level on a very fruitful carbon tax. The problem is that we already know that this way has not been able to be fruitful before, and it doesn't say it could it could be a possibility in the future. I think carbon tax is definitely one of the major tools that are for governments to play with. Because the thing is that, and I think you put it really good, Raymond, when you said that the problem is not really that a lot of people that know about climate change is not enough afraid of it. It's just that they are too afraid of the policies to do something about it. And I think that too afraid is good to say right now, because what we have been seeing is actually that some of the technology shifts and some of the policies that have been put in place, carbon tax in Sweden, for example, has not actually led to a disaster in society, has not been dangerous to our society as we want it, in our personal relationships, in our possibilities to be having a fruitful future. So I think there is very much more to do on going out, showing that fossil-free reforms to transport sector, to energy sector, can and will probably be both more easily done, cheaper, and makes the society actually even maybe better than today. And getting away from the argument that this is just a big burden and a big responsibility, because it is, mm-hmm. but the possibilities is also very, very great. And I think that is actually what Sweden and other countries, also to some part Germany, with their enormous change of energy sector, that the investments and the incentive for the renewable in Germany has been marvelous. They have actually done more there than when they have been cutting down in the nuclear.
So I'm going to touch on the elephant in the room here. So if you introduce a carbon tax, it's really efficient. Doesn't that mean that, or either one of you, doesn't that mean that it gets cheaper with nuclear power? In relative, if you have a carbon tax, you have a tax on carbon, doesn't energy production with nuclear power, relatively seen, get
I think
a favor?
All alternatives look more attractive, like Ray said, mm-hmm. and if you give me the choice today, I'll pick nuclear for exactly mm-hmm. the same reason. But all the alternatives are better. Mm. And it's less attractive to use it. And I mean, just a little comment on what Åsa said. I mean, every time I talk to climate negotiators or former negotiators, they always say, well, we know it doesn't work with the carbon tax, but because we tried or something. But early on, there was a discussion of carbon tax versus this wonderful cap and trade proposal. And people somehow jumped on the cap and trade bandwagon, and I think many Europeans feel proud to have adopted a cap and trade system in Europe. But you know, that's almost like it's dangerous, because we feel so great in Europe because we did this wonderful thing. But Europe is a very small piece, and we have to make everyone agree. And I think today we know more. I mean, I don't think we know today that a carbon tax is not possible. I think people believed that before. Today, I don't think we know. And one reason is Ray's excellent illustration of Sweden. You know, you saw the curves. That's not that long ago that Sweden started with a very high carbon tax. What happened? Well, if you would listen to US politicians, they would think that the country would go down the drain. It went absolutely the opposite way. And it's not because of the carbon tax, but you know, you can live very well with the carbon tax, even when the rest of the world doesn't have a tax. So you hurt yourself with a tax, no one else does, and you survive. I mean, we now have that evidence. And the other thing is, actually, right now, I mean, there's lots of programs. I listened to that when I went here this morning on the radio about how oil is so cheap. Well, I don't know, take the opportunity. Put a tax, add a tax to the oil now.
Now is the time.
How bad can it be? Double it, because the oil price has fallen by 50%. Yeah. So now double it, so it's back up to 100%. What's the problem? Yeah. I mean, I think that there's many arguments, and I totally worry. I mean, the thing about this is that it's just ongoing. Ray made that very clear. It's just ongoing. We have to do something. And if the current approach is not changed, essentially, I don't know.
Ray, short.
I just had a quick comment about nuclear power. So, and again, this is from the standpoint of trying to break the United States logjam and how there are actually conservative solutions, fiscally conservative solutions. In the United States, we directly subsidize nuclear power in many, many ways. So we, and for some reason, this is a kind of interference in the economy
that Republicans like. Now, every other kind of interference is not okay, but this they like. Whereas the free market approach, what Milton Friedman would advocate is, well, don't subsidize nuclear power. If you think it needs a help, then make the better behavior more costly and let the market decide. So rather than subsidizing nuclear power and decided that, you know, the solution should be nuclear instead of wind or hydropower, just make the carbon more expensive. And then if nuclear power becomes competitive as a result, then you can let the market decide whether it should be nuclear or wind. And of course, nuclear should be charged a fair share of its real costs, like storage or waste. So.
I want to get back, before I let the audience in, to the human side, Karin.
Yes.
The most common question you get as a scientist when you lecture about climate is, what can I do as an individual? So do you have an answer to that question?
That's a big... very big question, and I can partly answer it by returning to what I think is, as a political scientist, I see the primacy of politics, and I must say I'm all for carbon taxes, even if the political feasibility of that can be discussed. But what can we as humans do? I think it's actually what humanity has done, and I must say, in defense of the negotiations, we have 2 years of climate diplomacy. One can see the glass as half full or half empty, but I must say, given that 195 countries are negotiating civilized, we have the climate convention, we have the Kyoto, and we will have a new Paris Agreement. But we should have reasonable expectations of what a multilateral process can deliver. And I must say that in Paris, even if the agreement will be quite weak, it will include all countries, not only under the Kyoto Protocol, 18% of the emissions. It will be one framework for taking climate mitigation action. But again, and I say this, how we should act as citizens. Kyoto is not the only game in town. We can do climate action at many levels. We see in cities, in US, there are like 900 cities who are taking far-reaching climate mitigation action. We as individuals and companies and civil society. So Kyoto is not the only game in town. We can act on many levels.
Okay, so I'm going to let the audience in if there's anyone who wants to ask anyone in the panel a question, and we have a couple of questions already up there. So if you want to address it to someone specific, say so. If you don't, just throw it out.
Well, it's to the politician, let's say. So I'm not from Sweden, so I don't know how it works with electric cars here in Sweden, because I know, for example, in Norway, you don't pay taxes for electric cars. So, I mean, when I go to Bergen on Oslo, I mean, it's plenty of Tesla car, because it's actually really cheap compared to the other one, where they have actually really high taxes. But how is it here?
So answer the question how it is, and maybe how you'd like to see it be.
Well, electric cars is one of the I think positive technical shift we can see in transport. We also need to see the mass transport in cities in a much higher, in a better way when it comes to transport. But electric cars is, and Norway has actually taken a lead, at least in European countries, being, of course, very big subsidies for electric cars, mm-hmm. taking away much of the taxes and also leading the way in the cities for free parking and so on, even to the degree that they now have more of queues in the lane of buses because of the electric cars. So maybe that is not a good sign for people to see that, okay, I should have a very expensive electric car, which is heavily subsidized by the state, instead of taking the bus. Of course, in a climate smart way, we will introduce electric buses, and that will be introduced in Stockholm the next year, what I've heard from Vattenfall. And I think this is something we're looking at, and the subsidies in Sweden are there for electric cars, but they are not as big as in Norway, and we also therefore have not as big revolution yet.
But as a member of the government, I mean, one way to get the ball rolling on electric cars would be to just force all the government vehicles to be electric wherever possible. Wouldn't that be a way to kickstart, to get the prices down and maybe get the public more interested?
Well, definitely. And there is a very progressive way of public procurement, which we're using in the state. Mm-hmm. And we also have a lot of transport procured in local municipalities and so on. And they are actually in the forefront in Sweden. If you go to the big cities, they have much elaborated reforms for transport reforms in this. And I think we will see a big shift in electric cars and electric heavy vehicles.
So we have one question here and then one more up there. Well, yeah. We have one. Okay.
Yes. I assume that all of you take the plane very often and that you use a lot of carbon yourself. So my question is, do you think that some people in this fair idea should be allowed to use more carbon than others, and how should we handle that? Is there a better reason?
So is anyone wanting to pick that one up?
Well, this is an interesting question. I mean, I have an article about carbon commons and social justice about the issue of, what are the justifications for just dividing up the carbon allocations equally? And in fact, the whole notion of equality and moral philosophy is hard to really pin down. But it's hard for me to argue that anybody has an intrinsic right to more carbon. Now, on the other hand, some people may be able to use their carbon emissions with better use than others. And so my feeling is that if there were a really just allocation, everybody would get this little certificate, and then they would be able to sell it to somebody else to whom that emission might be more valuable, like someone who really needs to travel by airplane often for the sake of their business. But in terms of personal things, the one area where I have not been able to get my personal carbon down as much as I want is flying. So within Europe, I always try to take the train, but when I'm going back to the U.S. or often flying within the U.S., often traveling within the U.S., I just don't have an alternative. And I've tried to substitute telecommuting as much as possible, or teleconferencing. I did one of my students' thesis defenses in Chicago by teleconference instead of flying back for it. But getting the flying under control is difficult for people who do what I do.
Can I just quick comment? I think the question also reveals the difficulty with the negotiations, like what's fair? And you could imagine how many answers people come up with. They will tend to think that it's fair that they get a bigger share. That's, I think, the only thing we learn. Yeah.
Very quick one on that. Your question really points to the heart of the discussion, because there is also a lot of discussion on climate justice. And I would say we won't have an effective agreement in Paris that if it doesn't take seriously the justice issues. Well, your proposal, of course, is very radical, and it's something attractive with the equality. We may not reach that far, but I think justice and equity issues, they are increasingly debated both in the scholarly community and in the negotiations, so it's very important.
I'm really very happy to see so many hands. Unfortunately, time is limited, so I'm going to let two more questions in. And there's one way up there, and then one over here, and then we have to end.
Test. Oh, bra. Yes, I do have a question for Mr. Ray, specifically. Right now, nuclear energy is the best alternative instead of carbon. But I do have a question about fusion energy. Right now it's in the experimental stage, but I do wonder how long you think it will take for it to develop into a full-fledged alternative energy resource.
Right. Fusion energy is a really good example of how hard it is to predict technology development. Fusion energy has been, according to the people who do it, just around the corner every year for the last 60 years, basically. When I was first studying physics, it was something that they were finally going to solve. Every time they built a bigger machine, they discovered a new problem with it. Whereas when I was a college student, I don't think anybody anticipated how much computers, that I would be able to have in an iPhone something that was more than the whole computing power of the United States at the time. And that's not even an exaggeration. Nobody dreamed of that. It just wasn't on the horizon. And so, and fusion is still in that state. If it happens, it would be a game changer. But meanwhile, we do have technologies that we do know how to do. And they're problematic, like fission and breeder reactors. And I think that we should continue working on fusion reaction, but we should do more on the things that are known to be more feasible, which includes things like energy efficiency, but also learning how to make conventional fission reactors safer. There's a lot that can be done to address some of the real issues with safety of fission reactors. So I wouldn't bank on fusion. It's always been just around the corner. And that's for the same reason I wouldn't necessarily bank on us ever being able to suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. We don't know whether that technology will be like computers, in which case everything will be easy, or whether that technology will be more like fusion. It will just never come.
Okay, a final question.
Yeah, I will go back to the question about infrastructure. Ray showed that a lot of the fossil fuel consumption in Sweden is based on transport and liquid carbon. A lot of the infrastructure is the investments were made 50 or 100 years ago. Yeah. What magnitude of investments do we need to do now to assure a carbon-free infrastructure that is like transports as much people as it does today? Is it realistic to do it in a short time, or is it an impossible question to solve?
Yeah. Well, fortunately, Sweden does not have a lot of sunk capital in things like coal-fired power plants, which will stick around for 30 or 40 years. And a lot of the other systems, like transportation systems, are pretty flexible. The fleet turnover time for cars is pretty quickly, and they use the same roads. So I think there is a good chance for fairly quick turnover in the infrastructure. And given that most of the carbon emissions are liquid fuels, and very little liquid fuel is used for heating anymore in Sweden, that almost completely disappeared starting between the 70s and the 80s. It really is transportation, and it's a mix of industrial transportation like forestry and personal transportation and flying, and those things could turn over pretty quickly because they involve fairly capital stocks with fairly quick turnover time. But in terms of the amount of money, I'm not good with money. I don't even look at my bank statements until I find something wrong. But
so I'm going to give the last and final word to Åsa to answer that question as well.
Well, I think it was a good question, because when we're talking about investments in infrastructure, we realize very, very, very soon that this is a collective decision that has to be made, because those investments are made a lot with the public society as a driver. You could look at the train services, the public transports in cities, the innovation investments, making it possible for the private capital to also come into sectors, providing us fossil-free fuel that we will need in the future, but also providing a generation of electric cars and hybrids that could actually make a big, big difference. I think that efficiency is a good tool. It has been in the energy sector and when it comes to electricity so far, but in Sweden we have been not very efficient when it comes to looking into transportation. I think the paradigm shift is coming when it comes to the internet and the telecommunication, and I could just say that to this university, I think you still have some work to do when it comes to telecommunication instead of flying to conferences, instead of bringing everybody together at the same place every day, and so on. We have a big process that can do that, and we have very big possibilities in Sweden. We are people that are, I think we have the most telephone and computers per capita almost in the world, so there are opportunities, and we also have a lot of biomass that we can do fossil-free fuels of. So this is a possibilities for our economy, for our society, but also for actually making this window of a good example that is the key factor for the negotiations in Paris.
Thank you very much, all of you. Unfortunately, we're out of time, so I have to break here. I'd like to thank the panel. I think we'll do it by applauding them. And I also have a little gift, a little symbolic gift to everyone in the panel. And finally, I would like to thank the auditorium, for if you haven't come here, it would all have been quite pointless.
All of you, Ungdomer, if you have more questions, send me email. Don't all come to my office at once, it won't fit. But but I'm always happy to talk to you guys. And if I come to your school, whatever. So.